Hello there and welcome back to the channel. In this video I'm going to be giving you an update on the ZWO Seestar S30 smart telescope which I reviewed in my last video. I've learned some new things about it, I've got some additional features to tell you about and some tips to give you on things that I've learned since I've had this product. So let's get started. The first thing I want to do is show you how to check your firmware and your app are up to date. So I'm going to go onto the unit, I've connected to the unit with the app, and I'm going to click on me at the bottom right hand corner, and then you can see the firmware revision, and I'm on version 3.68. Now when you run up the app and connect, you will find if there's a firmware update available, it should offer to download and install that for you, and I've just downloaded 3.68 this morning. To check the app revision, you click on the cog at the top right hand corner and click about at the bottom, and you can see here just under the logo where it says Seestar, it's version 2.2.1. So I now know that I am using the latest version. I've been into the app store and there's no update available to that, and I've got automatic updates set up anyway. The next thing I want to tell you about is a bit of news that I received from ZWO a week or two ago, which is that they decided to include a carry case in the box with the production model of the S30. And they kindly agreed to send one to me, and it's now arrived. So let's have a look at the Seestar S30 carry case. So here is the carry case. It's made out of foam. It's very lightweight. It's got Seestar written on the front. It's got a kind of black sheen effect material coating on the outside of the foam. It's got a zip around the outside. And let's have a look inside. So inside we've got a main compartment for the Seestar itself. And let's just have a go at popping that in there. And that fits very snugly. We've also got an additional compartment down the end here. That'll take the tripod legs, and then in the lid we have a zip that we can undo, and there are two compartments. One looks like it's intended for the solar filter, which fits in quite snugly just there, and I think the other, I checked it with my iPhone, it's not really iPhone sized. I think that's really for putting your USB cable into. So it's a nice little case and a good addition to the product. That if you buy one, it should arrive in a case like this. Now before I continue, I just want to give a big thank you to everybody who has watched my channel, subscribed to my channel, has clicked the like button and or has given me some comments or feedback to my videos. I really appreciate all of you, especially those who give me feedback and say nice things. It's always nice to receive encouragement. If you haven't already subscribed to the channel, please do so. It doesn't cost anything to subscribe to a YouTube channel. It just means that you can then click on that little bell icon to choose to be notified when I create new videos so you don't miss anything. So thanks again, and let's crack on with the S30 update. So the next thing I want to show you is a new feature that was added in, not in this latest firmware version, but earlier than that. And that is the framing facility, also known as Mosaic Mode, or referred to as Mosaic Mode by ZWO. And this is a really exciting new feature because it allows you to image a bigger area of sky than you could before, and also because it allows you to take images that don't have that horrid and noisy effect at the edges caused by the field rotation during long exposures, especially ones near the zenith straight up. So I'm going to show you this. I'm going to go into Sky Atlas and choose the object M31. And you can see that it doesn't frame very well. But if I click on framing, I can change the amount of sky that is included in the shot up to 2 times. And I can also click on the rotator here and I can rotate that. So that's giving you a much better framing of M31 and its companion galaxy M110, in fact, than you could do before. And when you set that running, it takes images and stacks them in the normal way, except that it does so on a larger canvas. And as it goes, it starts to spiral in an outward direction to gradually fill in all of the gaps around the edges. It does take quite a bit of time, and it advises you how long you should image for to get a complete mosaic, but you can see anyway how much it's done. But it's really effective, and I'm showing you here how it builds up and what the final image looks like, which is like this. So very well done to ZWO for adding that feature. It's really super. What I want to do now is show you the scenery mode. Now on the top menu we have this scenery button, so I'll press that. And now we can see the image from each of the two cameras, the telephoto and the wide angle. So if you press on the inset image, it swaps the two. So I can swap between them like this. And now I can steer around with this joystick button here. I have it on fast and I can steer it to the left quite quickly, like this. And another way of making it point somewhere different is to press in the image itself. So for example, I can press on the rhododendron there and then press again, and it will repoint the camera to that location. I can press on the bird, click go, and it goes to the bird. But you can see that the bird is moving around. So this is a good opportunity to show you the tracking feature. So the button at the top right with the man running, I can press that and I can put a rectangle around the pigeon, and it will now track the pigeon. So if I can now shoot a video, for example, and it will follow the pigeon wherever it goes. And this is the cue for the pigeon to walk. Are you going to walk? Off we go. There it goes. And you can see that it's following the pigeon as he walks around on the lawn. So that's a nice little feature. So I'll hit stop there. You get a message at the top telling you it's saved to your Seestar. So if you want to watch that back, you can press the gallery button at the bottom left, go into Seestar, and then scenery album. And there's the video that I've just taken, and I can play it back. Okay, so far so good. I can also take still shots, of course. Take a photo there. If I turn off the tracking and I switch to the telephoto lens, I'm actually going to let's go and point at the rhododendron over here and switch to the different to the telephoto lens. I'm going to steer just upwards a little bit, just so I'm pointing at an interesting bit of the plant. How about that? That's fine. And now I'm going to run an autofocus. So the AF button is the autofocus, and it's now refocusing, and it will go white when it's finished. Okay, and that's worked. There's a question mark button at the bottom on the right hand side, and that just brings up text next to the other buttons to tell you what they do. So track, lightness adjust, and joystick. Although it's a little hard to read there. And the plus minus button is a brightness adjustment. So I can drop the brightness, for example. Actually, that's improved it quite a bit there. It was a little bright on the little bud there. But there is also a manual option there where you can change the exposure and the gain. So it could be useful. Okay, I want to take a still shot. I can take a picture. Now you notice at the bottom there's 1x, 2x and 4x. If I switch to 2x, it does a 2x digital zoom on that image. I can take a picture with that. But you notice it's starting to pixelate, and if I go to 4x, it will be even more pixelated because it's a digital zoom. So personally, I prefer to stay on 1x. Now the other thing we have is a time lapse. So I'm going to set the time lapse interval to 2 seconds and hit go, and I'm now recording a frame every 2 seconds. In fact, what I'll do is I'll put it tracking the bird, and now I'll do a time lapse. And what this does is every 2 seconds or whatever interval you've set, it creates a single frame of a video. So it will produce a video with one frame for every period that you set up. So at the moment, I can see I've got 18 frames. I think I'll wait till I get to 30 frames and then I'll stop it. And we can play back and see what the time lapse looks like. Nearly there. 30, okay, I'll hit stop. And I'm going to go into the gallery, into the Seestar. And here we go. Here's my time lapse. I can press play. And you can see the pigeon moving around very quickly. So that's the time lapse feature. Okay, so that is the scenery mode on the Seestar. It's a really good addition. It allows you to photograph landscapes or wildlife, which gives you another dimension to what you can do with Seestar beyond just for astrophotography. One more thing I want to tell you about is about something I learned from ZWO. I had a particularly troublesome session trying to do some deep sky astrophotography with it, where I waited 50 minutes and it rejected every single 10 second shot that it took, constantly reporting that it had star trails. And what ZWO told me was that there were some shortcomings in the horizontal calibration algorithm. And that if your horizontal calibration has not correctly measured the tilt of your unit, how much it's tilted and also in what direction it is tilted relative to the horizontal, then it will fail to track the sky correctly as the Earth rotates. And if that happens, then each 10 second shot is going to be tracked incorrectly, and the stars will be lines instead of points, and therefore the stacking algorithm will reject them, saying that they have detected star trails. What ZWO said was that if you make sure that your Seestar is properly leveled, then if the horizontal calibration were to fail, then you will still get a good stacking. And that's a really good tip. So I'm going to quickly show you how to do that leveling. I've already switched the unit on and connected to it. I'm going to go into Me, scroll down to Advanced Feature, and select Calibrate, and then Adjust Level. And you can see you've got these two circles here, and when they are exactly on top of one another, then you are perfectly horizontal. So if I lift up this leg here, you can see they drift apart in this direction. And if I lift up this leg here, you can see they drift apart in this direction. And here they lift up in this direction. Now the number is telling us what its measurement is in degrees as to how far we are away from horizontal. So right now, without touching it, it's saying I'm about 0.9 of a degree away from horizontal. And if I were to lift this leg up ever so slightly, I can improve that alignment and get it down to about 0.1 of a degree. And I could just put something under the leg there to shim it effectively. Or if you've got it mounted on a ball head tripod instead of with the little tripod, then you can just adjust the angle until that's level. Once you're done, you just press finish adjusting and you can come out of this menu back to the top and you're ready to go. So I thought that would be a really useful tip to share with you. Well, I hope you found this video useful. I certainly benefited myself from some of those things that ZWO told me about, and hopefully you'll enjoy those new features. Do let me know how you get on in the comments, and if you've got any questions, do feel free to ask, and keep an eye out for the next video. Take care.